stuff, you know, it's not good for you. But anyways, the turkey will be good. I don't know about the trimmings. But anyways, you can. We'd love to have you out. And that really is for everyone. There is no child care for that event. And so there's kind of an age limit of 14 above on that. So that would be great. And of course, next week, you already heard just the one service over the weekend with communion as the main portion of our service next Sunday. All right. And so that will be great. And I know you have family coming in to be with you over the holidays. Bring them to church next week, all right? And we will have a great time together. All right, we're going to receive our morning tithe and offering. Before you reach down for that bucket, Gabe's excited. And before you reach and grab that bucket, let me just tell you that as we head into the holiday season, I know there's extra stress in regards to money, right? Okay, maybe I'm the only one that worries about a little extra in this time of year. But folks, let me remind you of a few things. First, in regards to giving, it's an opportunity to be obedient. Secondly, we reap what we sow. Thirdly, giving even during the Christmas season is an acknowledgement that God owns everything. Fourthly, it helps us to gain an eternal perspective. And finally, we give because God gave first. And it is an act of love as we give. And so, you know, you may not have planned to give today, but folks, I want to tell you that it's not too late. We have many phenomenal givers in this church, and they give each and every week. And I just want to commend you for your ongoing faithfulness, and you're doing it for all the right reasons. And if you haven't caught on to this yet, it's not too late to start by any means. And you will notice an immediate difference in your life. And I know that sounds like a bold statement, but I know it to be true. And so as we practice, as we take that step of faith, I want to encourage you that even in the craziest season of the year where money just seems to be tight, this is a great time to begin. So if you're at the end of the aisle and you've already grabbed that bucket, hold on to it for just a moment. We're going to pray together. We're going to receive our morning tithe. An offering. Father God, we thank you for every dollar and every dime today. We pray that way almost every week, and it's true. We thank you, God, that we have this opportunity to worship, to give back. And Father, what a crazy time of year it becomes. And it's a great deal of fun, but there's also a lot of stress that comes. And Father, one of the things that we begin to worry about is whether we're going to have enough during the holiday season. God, I pray that as your people are faithful, that God, that you would pour out unexpected blessing in their life. That God, that you would meet their needs. That God, that you would do miraculous things, that they would know that the hand of God is upon their life. And so, Father, as we receive offering today, tithe and giving to ruin, God, I pray your grace over it all. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You may pass that along the aisle, and that would be great. And, of course, you heard about script. Folks, you can help us a great deal by participating in Scrip. There are a few Scrip items out there that are paying back to us roughly 18% right now during this season. And so you can find out from Cindy. Is it 18 that's bad? Yeah, 18%. You can find out from Cindy. And those are things you actually buy. So there you go. All right. So, all right. Well, it begins. The countdown to overeating begins. Set your clock, right? Is there something that you're going to eat this Thursday that you just know you shouldn't have, right? Anyway, like, let's start with the 60 pounds of gravy, all right? Just. You may want to get somebody else some, right? I mean, gravy goes with everything, right? It goes with the Jell-O salad. I don't get it. But just put the gravy on. Now, I mean, gravy, that's too much of a good thing, I can assure you. How about having the whole Costco pumpkin pie to yourself? I mean, folks, I mean, this is that week where we just begin this idea where it's really hard to be strong. The other night, Donna came home with a bag of chips. Folks, there is a perfect food group made up of two items. Cheesecake and chips. That is God's perfect food group. In heaven, cheesecake, chips. That's it. I know it. I know it. It's in Revelation. Check it out. And And she came home with a bag of chips. Now, folks, I haven't had chips probably in months. I love chips. And there was the bag on the counter, unopened. Phew, as long as it wasn't open, I'm good. Because I didn't want to be the one showing a little weakness in the house and actually opening it up. But my son, who knows no shame, walks over and goes, "Oh, chips." Opens the bag, has like five, walks away. I'm going, five? How on earth can you have five chips? My hand touches at least two dozen on the way in, and you know it's not polite not to eat what you have touched, right? So to be polite, I have to eat all 24 that I ate. And now 24, those... Is there like an AA group for chips? Like, I fell off the wagon. I thought, okay, I'm not going to sit down. I'm just going to stand here and have a few. Pretty soon, I am looking at the bottom of the bag. And it's the family bag. And I'm looking at the bottom of the bag, and I'm going, how did that happen? They hardly put anything in these chip bags anymore. Those distributors are terrible. They're ripping us off. They've hardly given me... I finished that bag in 15 minutes. Come on! There's something wrong here. Folks, I got to tell you that there are some things that are just... It's really hard to be strong about. It really is. I know that's just a silly thing, but you know what? It may not be chips in your life, but there may be things that are eating at you that it's very tough to be strong about. Do you know we're heading into this five-week stretch where those that have any acclimation towards depression will see elevated levels of depression over these next 5 weeks. Folks that have substance abuse issues, if they have a controlling substance in their life, be it drugs or alcohol, that consumption increases over this holiday time. Those that where there is abuse in the family, incidences of abuse arise something like 20-some percent over the next 5 weeks. And for many, it begins this Thursday when people are sitting around your table, some family members that you've not been doing very well with for a very long time, and now that they're sitting at your table, it reawakens wounds and very raw emotions. And it begins. Let me ask you a question. Are you strong enough to live up to all the challenges that come to you, not just at the holidays, but every day? Or have you kind of bought into this victimized mentality that you are stuck and you are going to be forever weak? You know, here's the cool thing. That God created me, God created you to be an overcomer. He really did. All of us to be overcome. I'm not strong enough in myself. Just put a bag of chips in here and I'll prove it to you. Please, no jokes. Don't send me any chips for Christmas, please. Just don't do it. That would not be fair, all right? But folks, I'm not strong enough in myself, but with Christ. Hey, there's a good line. Yeah, that's true. With Christ. See, it all changes because of Christ. This whole thing is different because of Christ. That which you struggle with, that you are just getting beat up about and you don't feel strong enough in, can change because of Christ. And you're going, well, it's just the spiritual stuff. No, it's not just the spiritual stuff. It's everything. Because you are just a big bunch of it all, right? And because of that, God wants you to come to Him through His Son, Jesus, so that you will not be defeated this season. You know what? Here's what happens. This is the last sermon in this excuse series, and this whole idea of not being strong enough is one of the most deceptive. Because you see, as we begin to say we're not strong enough, we kind of lock away habituated thinking. And unfortunately, we spend years believing that we're not strong enough personally, or we're not strong enough spiritually, or we're not strong enough emotionally. And then somehow we're not as capable as others. And it only takes a little bit of criticism in your life to activate this idea that you're not strong enough. You know, oftentimes it's not the major things in our life that puts us over the edge, right? It's the straw that broke the camel's back. I don't even know what that means, but I've said it all my life, right? And some of you are going, oh, now I get to look up that while I'm in church. That's perfect. Don't do it, all right? Do it another time. But the straw that broke the camel's back, it's often the little thing that puts us now over that edge. And that putting over the edge now leads us to a place where we're saying, oh man, I can't deal with this. I'm not capable. I'm not a strong person. I'm not as strong as I thought I'd be or I'd want to be. And so I'm just gonna be the weak old me that I've always been. Folks, no greater lie could come from the pit of hell. That you are stuck just being your old self. You do not have to be stuck being your old self. Because you know what? When we begin to plant this negative seed in our life that we are just stuck being our old self, that we're not strong enough to overcome, then it creates this excuse in our life that is just really tough to get beyond, because it becomes like a habit. We just start sharing it every time and we just put it out there. And I know life happens, right? Let me show you out of Luke chapter 16, and this is very pertinent to where we are as a society, where people are still losing jobs and everything else, and this guy is about to lose his job, and you'll see why here. And Jesus is telling his disciples, and this is a parable, and it goes like this. There was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, "What is it I hear about you? Give an account." So the boss is calling his employee to accountability, right? We know what that feels like. "Give an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer." So he throws it out there. "Unless you've got some really good information for me, your job is history." Third verse. The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job." And here's what I wanted you to see. "I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg." Folks, here's what's very interesting. Oftentimes in life, as life happens, there are things that come along that are an absolute challenge to us. And it comes not necessarily all at once, but it just seems to get, it just kind of keeps piling on, piling on, piling on. And we get to that point where we finally begin to say, "I'm not strong enough." I got a video I want you to see at this time.
I'm strong to give me what I'm going through. Well, forgive me if I'm wrong. But this looks like more than I can do on my own.
So here's the secret. There's just some things that you're just not capable to be that strong in. But through Christ, who gives you strength. See, folks, I've had many experiences, and I know you have as well. Standing at the end of a hospital bed looking at a terminally ill patient and knowing what to say. And yet God, through His discernment and His grace, provides comfort. Or maybe like the video, you have faced a job loss or stuff is going crazy in your family and just it's nuts. And you finally get to the end of your rope and you say, "That's it! Can't take anymore. I'm not strong enough to do this." See, folks, this is why people fall into habits, or they turn to alcohol, or they turn to drugs, or they turn to other vices. You know what? Maybe you have been spared a lot of trauma in your life, but I can assure you this is not a testimony or a prophecy over your life, but there will be days. They will come. And so, are you ready? You see, it's about being ready for when it comes, because it's going to come in one way or the other. And you have to mentally prepare your life as much as you do spiritually. And in this series, Romans 12:2 has been essential, right? Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed, which is Romans 12, chapter 2, right? But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You see, when you set your mind to action, when you set that, and you set your mind to do that which God has asked you to do, to put into practice that which He has called you to be, something amazing happens. And when it comes, do you know that the Lord always prepares you for that which is going to come? Now, sometimes you go, "Man, I was just blindsided by that." But I can tell you, more often than not, that God in His love and mercy is preparing you for that which you are about to walk through. If you would stand back and begin to look and see, it is true. Prepare your, or renewing of your mind. And then what will you be able to do? Test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now, folks, when we're not strong enough, it's awfully hard to think about His good and perfect and pleasing will. But when we know how we connect to the source of that strength, it's a game changer. I want you to do something. I want you to push out the mental belief today that you are too weak. And then bring in the mentality that God is your strength. Really. Push out the belief that you're not strong enough and bring in the thought, the mentality, be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you are strong. Become active and vigilant in this, because if you're not, you see, you're not going to create that new kind of bravery or those action steps, or that maturity is not going to set and get cemented in your life. And you need to affirm that you're breaking free of thinking habits that have held you or convinced you that you're not a strong person. Here's some things that you may want to consider saying when you're going through a challenging time. I will never see myself lacking in strength again. Or my favorite, my strength comes from God, who is my source. And guess what? He knows no weakness. No weakness. Now, raise it over here in the back. Ray, wave at me. Now, Ray, go stand in front of the door, because I was teasing you before church. Now, if Ray's standing in front of the door and I have to make a break for it, I'm not going through that door. Ray's much too big. He's much too strong for me. I'm going to go there or there. That's my closest door. I'm going to make a break that way. Folks, what I'm getting at is, you know, we can appear strong. We can have everything going for what it is. But I'll tell you what, there is stuff that is undermining us in our lives. And unless we begin to stand on the strength of God's word for our life and begin to live right where He has called us to live and recognize that He's got a purpose in all things, not in some things, but in all things, then you know what it begins that's so wonderful is that as we really believe God, then strength is built in our life, and our character begins to reflect that strength, and our mind and our thinking process gets transformed, and we begin to walk even a little bit differently, not proudly, but we begin to walk with the sense that God is able. I don't know about you today, but is there a situation in your life where you need to be for God to be able, right? You know what I'm saying by that? Absolutely. There are some things that you just need to let God do today. There are some things that you have been trying to work out, and you've been going about it all the wrong ways. Hebrews 11 says an amazing thing, and if you were to read the whole chapter, you would be reading what I call the Hall of Fame of Faith, right? But you get down to verses 32, and it just begins to knock off the names in succession, and it goes like this. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell you about Gideon or Barack Obama. Just wanted to make sure you're still listening. You're still listening. There you are. I just wanted to make sure. It did catch my eye when I read it, too. Whoa, look at that. There is President of the United States right there. I do not have time to tell you about Gideon or Barak or Samson or Jephthah or David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, and who shut the mouths of the lions, and here's what I want you to see, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword. So the situations have been pretty dire. They're pretty tremendously large. The stuff of action movies right here, right? Whose weakness was turned to strength. Whose weakness. And you're going, well, God loved them more. God didn't love them anymore. If you would have asked them, they would say, God, why are you doing this to me? Right? If we're honest. Now, whose weakness was turned to strength. Who does that? Only God can do that. Only God can take our weakness and make it a strength. That is an amazing testimony in and of itself. And who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Man, I'm so blown away. And what God wants to do in my life and what God wants to do in your life and how he really wants to transform the way I think about the things that are holding me back from fulfilling that which he has called me to do. I believe very strongly that God places calling and dreams and vision in our life. I believe that sincerely. And why do I believe that? Because he's done that in my life since I was a child. And so I understand what that is and how I've walked through that, and I've done well with some of it, not so well with other parts of it. And there have been times in my life where I've been on such a spiritual high that I was no earthly good. And then pretty soon, the earthly good brought me back down to their way of living, and I wasn't any different anymore. I want you to turn your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm going to take you to a very interesting passage of Scripture, and I want you to open your Bibles to it because you're going to have to read this probably several times this week to really catch the meaning of what is going on here today. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 1, and it says this, I must go on boasting. Although there is nothing to be gained, I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. So this is Paul speaking, and this is a carry-on. There are other people that have claimed to be prophets and people of the good news, but they're charlatans, and they come up with all these stories and everything else. And so Paul has been talking about, you know, that all this boasting about what they've done really doesn't matter. But because you've forced me into the situation, I will now begin down their way of thinking. I know a man in Christ. Now this is confusing. Paul is talking about himself as in the third person. This is Paul. I know a man, in other words, I am that man, all right? So this is Paul speaking, who 14 years ago, that's when he was with Barnabas and Tarsus, was caught up to the third heaven. First heaven, second heaven, third heaven, there he is. You're going, third heaven. This is why I want you to spend some time reading this week, all right? Because there's a lot here. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. Okay, that's important to know. God knows. Next verse, very similar. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise. The reason that's important, some people say, well, Paul was transported into heaven. And others say, oh, he just had a dream. It says there twice, he doesn't know. He doesn't know. But what he does know was it was very real. So we don't take that away from it, that this was a very real experience. And up until this point, he had been secretive about it. He hadn't talked about it at all. Some 14 years he held this in secret. He heard inexpressible things, things that man is not permitted to tell. Next verse. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself except about my weaknesses. And you're going, now why is Paul talking like that? Well, again, it's part of the games and the semantics that the others have been playing. And so he's coming at them in a way that they're going to understand and that the way that they've been processing. And so he is processing now the same way they have processed. And that's what he's allowing himself to do. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool because I would be speaking. Ah, here's the key. I would be speaking the truth. He has just called the other ones out. He said, now in my boasting, what's different about my boasting from yours is mine is true. That's what he's saying. Because your boasting is, well, the fruit of their life did not line up with the message, you see. And they were pulling people away from Christ, pulling them back into the things of the law and saying you had to do this, that, and everything else, and then you could know God and everything else. And Paul is saying, no. The truth is this. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than it is warranted by what I do or say. This shows incredible humility, by the way. To keep me from becoming conceited because of these surpassingly great revelations. In other words, you should have been there. Wow. This is big. There was given me... Any of you got a thorn in your flesh? Now, don't raise your hand because your thorn is sitting right next to you. And I mean that in the nicest way possible. Pat, did you just flick Dawn in the back of the head? I saw that. There was given me a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord. You ever done that? God, please take this from me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take this from me, right? But he said to me, my grace. Oh, this is your memory verse, by the way. Many of you know this one already. But my grace you know, there's a lot of words here. It can be capable for you, and there's a lot of things, but this is the best word, is sufficient. In other words, it's complete. It's able to carry you. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect. Ah. In weakness. You see, sometimes we say we're not strong enough. We're trying to run away from everything that we're not strong about. But God is saying, hey, wait a second. My power is made perfect in your weakness. So hold on, buddy. Hold on. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness. In other words, testimony time. So that Christ's power may rest on me. Last verse. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. I can tell he's in ministry. Just reading through the list, I can tell. For when I am weak, sorry, inside ministry joke. For when I am weak, then I am wow. So, let's get this right. So Paul is having this deal. He's being challenged about faith. People are trying to steal people for these new believers and try to bring them back into an old way of living. And so now he's kind of forced into getting into their arguments and breaking them down a little bit. And finally he throws the zinger. Well, my stuff is true. And then he's talking about it from the sense that these other ones wanted to be seen as these great spiritual authorities. And Paul's saying, okay, let me tell you something about seeing something from heaven. I saw something so vivid that I probably don't even have the words to explain to you what it is that I saw. And it was so amazing, and I've been basically told not to talk about this, but today I get to talk about this. But, you know, this would make me like a super spiritual person. And isn't that what we do? We sometimes make heroes or celebrities out of people of faith because they've got this great story and we go, oh, that's going to be great. And, you know, you're so powerful and spiritual and everything else. But God would not allow that for Paul. He said, yeah, okay, Paul, I've given you a taste of heaven. I've given you a glimpse that nobody else has seen. And because of it, whammo! You're going to have this thing that's going to kind of keep you from moving forward. And we don't know exactly what it is. There's all kinds of possible things that this could have been. It could have been a physical sickness. It could have been eye problems. Some say he developed a speech impediment. All kinds of different stuff. The other people even talk about malaria and headaches and all that kind of stuff. We don't know. But what we do know is that God allowed it. That's what we do know. And folks, here's the thing that makes Paul very, very human, and I want you to hear this morning. It is understandable that Paul would consider this thorn in his side a hindrance to wider and more effective ministry. Because isn't that what we do? Oh God, if you would just take this from me, then I would be able to do da, 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 da. And you're going, I've never been called to the ministry of duh. I'd like to know what that means. But you get it, right? We've often said, Lord, if you would just take this from me, then I would be more effective. And so much so that Paul says in his own words, I prayed about this on at least 3 occasions that it would be taken from me. But Paul learns that divine power is best displayed against the backdrop of human weakness. So that God alone can be praised. Rather than moving or removing the problem, God gave him grace in it. And some are going, I don't want grace for my problem. And I know that sounds funny, but it's true. We don't want grace. We want God to fix it. Folks, you have to understand, he is fixing it. It just may not feel like that, which you thought it would be. So, actually, God had to get mad at Paul a little bit and speak to him and say, in reality, Paul, what you're trying to do is throw away my gift of suffering, and I'm not going to do it. It's a really tough thing, isn't it? Because I know many of you, and I know things, I look around the room and I know some of the things that you've been talking about, some very difficult things. But God's promise is real and true. He said that he will never allow you to be tempted beyond that which you could bear, right? And he says that his grace is sufficient for you. And then when you say, no, it's not, then what you're saying is, oh, God, you're wrong. And now you have another issue. You've got something that you need to get right with the Lord. And folks, I know that sometimes in our suffering, we say things that we never wanted to say. But we have to understand that God's grace relates to all his sufficiency, whether things are going good in our life or it's going crummy in our life. And Paul, in the natural, wanted to increase his power by this because he just felt like he could run the marathon that much better, run the race that God had called him toward, heavenward towards, right? He could run it better if he didn't have this thing slowing him down. But power for Paul's life came, seeing weakness as the very vehicle for manifesting Christ's power through him. The people that heard and saw Paul recognized that he was broken, saw him as someone that was suffering. And so when he would speak and teach, And under the power of the Holy Spirit do that which he did, it was truly the work of God. His weakness showed inadequacy in this shell, but it would affirm the ever-present grace of the Holy Spirit working in his life. Huh. What are you struggling with today? Where do you feel weak? You know, sometimes as a dad, as a husband, I feel like I'm the fixer, right? Any fixers in the room, right? You just got to fix it. And so sometimes when I'm thinking about God, my Father, I go, God, I know how I would react to this. I would fix it just like this, telling God exactly how this should go. No, come on, I'm just being honest. You do the same thing. I know you do. And you know what? I think he says, hey, I appreciate the time you've put into thinking about that. Thanks for thinking about it and passing that along. I'll take it under advisement. Not. Because my way is different than your way, Jeff. Folks, God's ways are different than our way. And so why wouldn't it be that when we're weak, that he would come along and give us grace that would be sufficient, that he would come about it a way different than the way we would? Because if he just did it the way we asked for him to do it, and sometimes he does, and I think that he just does that to mess with our heads, by the way. But anyways, because it's not for our glory, it's for his. It is for his glory. You know, we are going to sit around the tables Thanksgiving this week. And we have much, so much to be thankful for. And yet, there will be some this week that will struggle with this whole idea that God is strong in their life. God is strong in our lives. It doesn't mean that you, as Paul would say, you keep on sinning or you keep on making the same mistakes. It means you grow from that and you move beyond it. That's what it says. Do you know what Christ is doing right now? He sits at the right hand of his Father and he says, have you considered this individual, you? And God looks at his Son Jesus. And as our advocate, he sits there before the Father and he tells God all the wonderful things about you and I. Now, for some of you, that list is shorter or longer than others. But here's the key thing on the list. Well, he's been cleaned up. Or she's been saved because of that death on the cross that I did, that you called me to do, that I was obedient to, that was a part of your plan, my Father. Because of that, you know, because of that, when God looks through Jesus to see you and I, what do you think he sees? He doesn't see your sin. Why? You know why he doesn't see your sin? It's because it's been covered by the blood. And so when, this is wild to me, when God looks through his son, it's not like he doesn't know, but he chooses to look through his vessel, his son, who paid the price for you and I, and he sees you and I as part of the family. It's true, right? We don't have to debate this, right? So if that's true, you have the strongest advocate working on your behalf today. You have the go-to guy. And he is working it for you. Amazing. It is amazing. I want you to go ahead and take out your connection card. I want to draw your attention to a few things. First off, if you're our guest today, right here on the front, has a place for your name and address and all that kind of stuff. And I promise you, this is worth your time. And of course, if you're a regular attender and you've changed any of your information as of late, we would love to have that. Or you can just even sign in with us today. That's helpful. Last week, I got to tell you, We had the most prayer requests ever given to us this past week. We had some 20 pages of prayer requests come to us, and that's how we know it's getting close to the holidays. Because we get a little bit nervous and worried. It's what happens. So we had some 20 pages, and I want to thank you for that. Onto the backside of that card, I want to direct your attention to a few things today. Of course, we always have these areas here. I want to take my first step with Jesus today. We'll talk about that in a moment. Talk about or know more about ruin or servant areas. We got four specific areas that we have some needs today, and you can see those right there. But I want to direct your attention to my next step. Memorize 2 Corinthians 12:9. Extra reading. That longer passage out of Corinthians, and then I've provided some information out of Ephesians and John that just really brings it home. But I want to direct your attention to these three things. Number one, I am thankful for grace in times of weakness. Sometimes when we're weak, what do? We complain. We complain, God, why are you doing this to me? How about we turn that around today? Say, God, I am weak today. I need you to be strong. And I will receive your grace in sufficiency today for where I am struggling. Right? Some of you are going to have a family member sitting across from you that you haven't talked to in years. You may need a little grace for them too. You may be that example of grace to another this week. Secondly, I will be humbled despite my many blessings. Paul had all the reason in the world to boast, didn't he? He had truly seen a vision unlike anything you and I have ever seen. He had reason to boast, but God wouldn't let him. He kept him grounded. He kept him grounded. And folks, we're to be grounded today. Grounded in the knowledge that God will come along where there's weakness in that grounding, and He will provide in a powerful way. And thirdly, I acknowledge that strength comes from God. You know, it's an amazing thing, strength. Sometimes I go to the gym. I know you can tell. Body by Jeff, right here. And I usually avoid the weight room because people walk funny in that room. Right? But every now and again, a friend will go, "Hey, come on over here, Jeff." Sure, right there. Goes, "Hey, I need some help here. I got to bench this." And he's throwing 45 plate after 45 plate, and I'm going, "Oh my goodness." And they'll get down there, and my job, right, is to spot, to make sure he doesn't drop that barbell with about 300 pounds on it and pop his head off. Because it would just explode if it hit him, right? It's a little bit of pressure. And he'll be pushing the weight. And then he'll get to about number 5 and it starts to slow down. And I'm going, "Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Please give him the strike." Back down, I'm going, "Glutton for punishment." And it comes back down and it starts up, and then the weakness begins to show in one side, right? Am I right? I'm thinking, this is so not worth it. Why do people do this? Because they want to look like this. And then it gets to the last rep, and it's almost on cue. They can't get there. And they get it about an inch. And the veins are showing up in their face. And they turn an alien color red. And the purple sets in and everything else. And I'm, "Oh my goodness, we need to call an ambulance." But then it's my cue. I have to reach in and help. And here's what I've learned. All I have to do is take one finger and stick it under the bar and just move it like that. And all of a sudden, it's like a miracle. All this power comes into that person's body and they're like, ah! How did it happen? Well, I'm incredibly strong with one finger. That is the moral of the story. Every day, 3 times a day, full reps. Go through every finger, both hands. No! I'm not powerful at all. This isn't showing any real strength. But I've come alongside. When someone is weak, and I've made them strong. That's what God does for you! Right? God, I can't! And he reaches in and goes. He doesn't even put the whole hand down. He doesn't have to. His grace is sufficient for you and I today. Why don't you stand with us as we sing together? God bless you. We'll connect or grab these connection cards in conclusion in just a moment. I want you to sing and worship in your best voice today. Your God is reaching down to you today to give you strength. God bless you as you sing.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song, sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Sing it out.
Sing holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty. your name. Jesus, Jesus, your name is power. Red and living water. Such a moment, history. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to invite my prayer friends to come forward at this time. You've filled out that connection card. The buckets are coming along your aisle. We will receive these connection cards at this time. Thank you so much for your prayer requests each and every week. It is phenomenal. But today, as we come for prayer, two things. If you are just working through a weakness today, if you've got those buckets, pass them along the aisles, all right? Go ahead. If they're at the end of the aisle there, should be on the left-hand side. Pass that along, please. If there's a weakness today, there's a weakness today that you just need God to be that grace, that sufficiency in your situation, then I would encourage you not to walk from this place and go, I'm good, I got it. I would encourage you to find a prayer friend today and just spend some time in prayer. They've come prayed up for you, you see. And so that which God started in their heart several hours ago now will be an amazing blessing to you. See, that's how it works. So they just don't all show up and go, oh, I got to pray today. No, they actually pray for you. So I want to encourage you, if you've got a weakness today where you need God's strength, come find one of my prayer friends today. Secondly, and just as important, you don't know how God can be strong in your life because you've never yet experienced how that works. But today, you heard me talk about Jesus sitting at the right hand of his Father, and that when God looks through his Son Jesus to us, that he doesn't see the sin, but he sees someone that is forgiven. And you, in your heart, you're going, I've never received that kind of forgiveness before. I've never asked God to forgive me of my sins. I've never asked him to be my advocate or to be my savior. I've never asked him to do any of that. Do I really need to do that? Well, I have it under good advisement that yes, this is the only way to eternal life. That's what Scripture says. John 14:6 says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. That's John 14:6. If you've not accepted the Lord as your Savior today, if you don't know the forgiveness of sin, Leo and Melody are waiting to pray with you today. Is there anybody in this service today that's ready to accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior? Is there anybody? I see it. It's all right. You can put it up. Thank you. Is there anybody else this morning? God bless you. You can take it down. Is there anybody else this morning? We're going to sing that song together again in conclusion, a little bit softer so we can hear you. But I want to invite you to come. Come for prayer. I got three young ladies that are waiting to come for prayer this morning. I see it. They're ready to come. So folks, come for prayer. God, I pray your grace would be upon these folks today. Lord, may your blessing be poured out upon their life. Lord, this week, Thanksgiving, I pray there would be great rest in their families. Needed rest from just these months of going, going, going. God, I pray all over this room for people that are just tired. God, that you would give them rest. God, I also pray that you would allow them to see your grace in operation as it will be challenged this week as we begin to step into the holidays. Maybe we're walking into the holidays for the first time without a loved one. And that is a challenge in itself. And God, in the weakness of that, that your strength would be sufficient in our situation. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Church, come for prayer. God bless you. Thanks for being here today. Thank you.